ド
ダ
デ
デ
morning sun kisses the windows, kisses the walls, opens the eyelids, opens the eyes of the husband and wife, kindles their faces, kindles their love, kindles their faces with greetings of love in the little white house in Wellesley.
Suburbia,
suburbia, our little spot out of the harbor, less than an hour by train.
Suburbia,
suburbia, sweet in the spring, helpful in winter, saves us the bother of summers in May. Morning sun kisses the driveway, kisses the lawn, kisses the flagstones on the front lawn of the little white house, kisses the paper at the front door, kisses the roses around the front door of the little white house in Ozone Park.
The little white house, the little white house.
Ratty boo, so far, so far, so automobile, automobile, so far, so far, ever over the boo, ever turn over, skiddly day, da, a bobbinel who, but a bobbinel buys a visa.
Suburbia, possum and the kids, neighborly butchers, less than an hour by train. That morning sun says a good morning,
have a good day, have a good morning, have a good day in the city today.
Joy to your labors till you return, joy to your labors until you return to the little white house,
to the little white house,
to the little white house in Highland.
White house,
shake a heart in Michigan Falls, in Beverly Hills.
White house,
skiddly day, skiddly day, ratty boo.
Say the thing that you did.
What is it this time?
In front of the kid.
You were the first to go up and score.
Always it's my fault.
I just made a joke.
Pass me the toast.
You might have said please.
Please understand, I don't mean to fight.
Why do you start that?
It's simply not right.
Righteous old Sam, so quick to accuse.
We are fighting.
The language you use.
This coffee is burned.
Make it yourself. Every morning it's the same old thing. Lovely way to start the day.
There are things that have to be discussed.
There certainly are. Everyone knows that you and Miss Brown.
You mean my secretary?
The talk of the town.
Me and Miss Brown, that homely old
Still
bird.
Still young enough to have
It's simply absurd.
Still young enough.
The subject is closed.
Oh, I'm sick of this life. Day after day of the same humiliation. Day after day with no consideration of what it means to be a woman. A woman needs so little, a little feeling of warmth, a little feeling of warmth.
Try, Dinah, try to be kind.
Darling, you know, it's Julia's birthday.
Is it his birthday?
Oh, no, it's the play.
Oh, I forgot that awful school show.
Julia's the hero.
Time do we go?
At 4 on the dot.
Fine, I'll be there. Sorry, I can't. I'm due at the
gym. Sam, but we're promised.
What's it to him?
Everything, Sam. You really must try.
Ina, I'm sorry.
He's wearing your tie.
I'm due at the gym.
To hell with the gym.
Don't you see, today's a special day. Handball tournament and all.
No, I don't see why it's so important.
Important to me. If I win today, I win the gold cup.
Isn't that dandy?
The tournament cup.
You and a cup. Your ego is wild.
And it's important.
But think of your child.
Our junior's all right.
Handball in
you. You lead your life. And leave me to mine.
Oh, but you're selfish.
And we'll get on fine.
You'll have a child, and he should come first.
Can't you stop nagging?
I'm ready to burst.
Oh, this can't be the way. Why can't we once have a friendly conversation? Must we descend to this vulgar demonstration? Once and for all, let's stop this brawling. Tonight, let's talk it over. Relaxed and candid and free, as grown-up people should be.
Oh, by the way, my money's run low.
Oh, not again now.
My doctor, you know.
Doctor, my foot. An out and out
fake. These great analysts.
The money they make.
You ought to go too.
I'm late for my train. Mr. Partridge. I'm perfectly fine, thank you. She's well. Yes, exactly what I want to speak to you about. With things as they are, I cannot see how you can ask me again. Now, Mr. Partridge. Yes, I know all that. You've already said that. Ah, but that's just why I have to refuse you. No. No. Yes, I was sure you would finally see it my way. No trouble at all. Goodbye.
Oh, Sam, you're a genius, you marvelous man. Sam, you're a genius, you marvel of a man. When it comes to the dollar, no one touches marvelous Sam.
Yes. Oh, Bill, good morning. I couldn't be better, Bill. She's well. Yes, the check is already signed and waiting. Now, don't be a child. You know it's a pleasure to do it for you. Is it sufficient? Don't be silly, man. Of course, I can spare it. You'll return it whenever you want to. Sure. Bye. Hey, don't forget to show up for the handball finals. at 4 on the dot. So long.
To touch his serving hand.
I saw him then. I saw his face. I ran to him. He vanished like smoke. I reached, I called, and I awoke.
Sorry, Mrs. Smith, your time is up.
Well, of all people.
I'm on my way to lunch with Susie.
And I've got a date with old AJ. Same old business lunch. Too bad we can't have lunch today.
I must run. I'm late already. See you tonight.
Skiddly day, lovely day, lovely life. happily married, sweet little son. Family pictures, second to none.
It's a wonderful life.
Up-to-date kitchen, washing machine, colorful bathrooms,
and Life magazine,
and a little white house in Brookline. Lovely life. Sheraton sofa, Chippendale chair, Apple white table, bone china ware. It's a wonderful life. Cream solid silver, wine in the soup, two door sedan and convertible coupe, and a little white house in Elkins Park.
Suburbia,
suburbia, 6 days of work, fun every Sunday, golf with the neighbors next door.
Suburbia,
suburbia, vitamin B,
chlorophyll toothpaste. Who could ask heaven for anything more?
Happily life, oodles of culture, over TV, book of the month club, musical tea.
It's a wonderful life.
Happily married, sweet little son. Family pictures,
second to none. In the little white house,
in the little white house,
in the little white house,
little white house in Bloomfield. White house,
and men who cannot. There are fish who go swimming and fish who wind up in the pot. There are men who will study the books till judgment day and examine the techniques of winners galore. There are men who will practice the rules religiously. Every day they'll improve just a tiny bit more. And they put all their soul behind it, all their ego, power, and drive, and will, and desire behind it. And they throw themselves in. But they never will win, they never will win, they never, 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 never will win. Men who are flabby and men who are thin. There are fish who are fattish and fish who are trim in the fin. There are men who will sweat up their days in cabinets and be pummeled and badgered and beaten and rolled. There are men who will sweat up their nights in Turkish baths, thereby every reducing machine that is sold. And they live for a week on lemons, and another week on grass and water and crackers and lemons, and lay off of the gin. But they never be thin, they'll never be thin, they'll never, 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 never be thin.
About his dinner, he never will have to think about getting thinner, 'cause he's a winner, a nature boy, a hero in a story with a wonderful sequel. Men are created unequal. There are men that whatever they they touch will turn to gold, and that every decision will always be right. There are men who will handle the work of seven men, and some manage to sleep 7 hours a night. You can throw all your weight against them, all your fire, snow, and hail, and darkest disaster against them. They'll respond with a grin. For they always will win, they always will win, they always, 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 always will win.
Spring native words in my ear. Island magic.
standing here chattering? If I don't get going this minute, there won't be any dinner when Sam comes home!
There's a law that a man has to pay for what he gets, and that even the winner must pay through the nose. For there always arrives the moment when the payments begin. And I have to go in, I have to go in, I have to go in. We had a talk.
About what, dear?
A talk about us.
Certainly, Sam. I'm ready to hear.
Open and candid.
Whatever you say.
Where to begin?
That's up to you.
Impossible.
But you said you won't.
How can we talk when you interrupt?
Who's interrupting?
You never shut up.
What have I said?
Oh, it's no use.
Bringing the loved ones together, safe by the warmth of the firelight, the odor of cooking.
By the way, the carpenter came to finish the frame. Ought to look pretty. I thought maybe green.
Telling all intimate matters, telling all those little things that are only meant for.
What did you say?
It doesn't matter.
How was Junior's play?
I didn't go.
Look, Dinah, maybe we ought to go out somewhere tonight. A movie or...
We went out last night.
But there's a different one tonight, just open. That new musical.
Something about Tahiti?
How about it?
Sure. Why not? Anything. I'll get my things.
Waiting in time.
Yes, yes.
find the answer there. Maybe I don't know.
Sun kisses the windows, kisses the walls, opens the eyelids, opens the eyes of the husband and wife, kindles their faces, kindles their love, kindles their faces with greetings of love in the little white house in Wellesley.
Suburbia,
suburbia, our little spot out of the harbor, less than an hour by train.
Suburbia,
suburbia, sweet in the spring, healthful in winter, saves us the bother of summers in May. Morning sun kisses the driveway, kisses the lawn, kisses the flagstones on the front lawn of the little white house, kisses the paper at the front door, kisses the roses around the front door of the little white house in Ozone Park.
Little white house, the little white house.
Skiddly day, lovely day,
lovely life, happily married, sweet little son, family pictures, second to love,
it's a wonderful life,
up to date.
This story about this couple at a crossroads in their marriage belongs right at the beginning of the 50s. A time of great confidence, a time of people expecting the best out of their new car, their new home. People were, you know, the whole business of owning the new, great, burgeoning future, completely undercut by the story, which is, of course, that trust and being able to look after each other doesn't suddenly come right just because you pile possessions and a new prosperity into the world.
You say the thing that you did.
What is it this time?
In front of the kid.
You were the first to grow up in
school. Always it's my fault.
I just made a joke.
Pass me the toast.
You might have said please.
Dinah is a woman who got herself into a situation at a young age where she just wasn't happy. She probably just felt that it was what was required of her. Like said, no other choices. And now has a loveless marriage and kind of has lost a sense of herself and, yeah, very neurotic.
Okay, and nice and still, roll sound.
I find myself getting very tearful when listening to this woman trying to find out what it is about her life that's gone missing. This relationship with this man who she once loved has kind of left her high and dry, and he indeed as well, but that sense of emptiness with the warmest music is an extraordinary kind of pull, a kind of sort of tug at the heartstrings. It was a very cruel piece in the sense that he needed some kind of revenge, or perhaps some kind of closure, as we'd say now, on what had happened to him as a child. The torment of what he saw as a very, very poor or damaged upbringing.
Trouble in Tahiti is one of Bernstein's early pieces, so it's got an experimental quality about it. And it was written before West Side Story and before Candide. And unlike them, it is sort of half an opera and half a musical, and it's got both elements strongly in. It's got big operatic scenes and scenes that are actually more in the style of a musical.
Every single dramatic moment is coloured with a completely different musical rhythm and musical idea. They come from so many different corners of Bernstein's own life and so many different corners of the musical kind of planet that it's quite difficult to create one rhythm. And I don't think one should try to make it, you know, a flowing piece. It's a series of very, very sharply judged, extremely detailed and cruelly kind of delineated moments, which only last for a few minutes at a time.
God, sorry, I called the wrong people, okay? Nathan was trying to catch you.
I think at the time, it was particularly difficult for people to actually listen to a piece that was about the trouble and the anxiety of the age, when actually what they wanted to look forward to was a very bright, easy sort of sunrise future. And Bernstein wasn't prepared to give them that. It's very uncompromising. And it will always be difficult to encounter pieces like that. But actually, you come out the other side, it's rather like the characters at the end of King Lear, when they actually can see that what they have lived through will give them some new and better appreciation of what they should be doing with their own lives. And I think that's something that's very, very deeply satisfying about watching this piece.
I don't think anybody knew every side of Leonard Bernstein. He was such a complicated Jekyll and Hyde character. He said himself once he was a Jekyll and Hyde character. You see, he was both famous as a composer of popular music, such as West Side Story and On the Town, shows that hit Broadway, made a big success. But he was also a composer of three symphonies and a mass and a number of other major works for the concert hall. So already there's a duality in his composing life between the serious composer and the lightweight, or some would say lightweight, others would say great Hollywood composer and great Broadway composer, because he was both those things as well. So there's that part of Bernstein. Then there's another part of Bernstein who was a conductor. Now, conductors are tremendous extroverts. They have to produce themselves, play themselves out on a concert platform for 100 players when they're leading a symphony orchestra, for an audience of 3, 5, 20,000, according to where they're playing. So on the one hand, you've got Bernstein, who's a thinker, who's a quiet man, who's spending his nights thinking about his music and composing. On the other hand, you've got a playboy almost, a man who's constantly on the go, who's pushing himself and pushing everybody who's with him. So there's a duality there as well. Then there's a duality between Leonard Bernstein, the American. He's an all-American boy. He was the first American of any note to not be taught in Europe. Most American composers of the previous generation, Aaron Copland, Virgil Thompson, people like that, they went to study mostly with Nadia Boulanger in Paris. Bernstein did all his studies in America, partly because there was a war on when he was growing up, so he couldn't have gone to Paris. But in any case, I think he felt himself to be your actual American boy, Jewish American boy, who's going to make good in a Gentile world, because there weren't too many Leonard Bernsteins. Bernstein was a very common name, but he was actually urged to change his name because his mentor, Serge Koussevitzky, said, "You'll never get anywhere with a name like Bernstein. It's too common. Why don't you have Burns, Leonard Burns?" And Lenny said, "No, I think I'll stick with Bernstein. It was good enough for my father. I'll make it good enough for me." At the time that Bernstein was writing Trouble in Tahiti, this is in the early 1950s, he was already a wunderkind. He'd had a big success in 1944 when he was 27, conducting the New York Philharmonic Orchestra without any rehearsal. Bruno Walter, the great German conductor, was down to conduct, but he fell sick on the eve of the concert, phoned in, said, I've got flu, I can't do it. Mr. Rodzinski, who was the formal conductor of the orchestra, was up in his country home. He said, get Bernstein to do it. That's why we hired him. He's the assistant conductor. There'd never been an assistant conductor who actually conducted a concert for many, many years before that. But Lenny had the chance, had the luck, and it was broadcast nationwide. It was broadcast worldwide because it's 1944. All the sort of cultural concerts were broadcast to the American troops, wherever they were around the world. And overnight, he was famous. He was front page news of the New York Times. 7 years later is when he wrote Trouble in Tahiti. And in between that time, he'd had a huge success also writing a musical for Broadway, On the Town. He could have made a Broadway success from then on as a composer of Broadway shows. But his mentor, his two mentors, one was Serge Koussevitzky, who was a great conductor of the Boston Symphony Orchestra. The other was the composer Aaron Copland. For different reasons, they both wanted him to concentrate on being a conductor. Broadway and Hollywood, that was beneath their dignity. I mean, I have to say this, there was a snobbism about it. And Bernstein, he was only in his 20s, he was influenced by these great guys, and he went along with their plans, which was that he should become a great conductor, that he should inherit Koussevitzky's mantle at Boston, maybe, and that he should be the person who conducted the new school of American composers, of whom Aaron Copland was the leader. But there was also William Schumann, and there was Virgil Thompson, and there were Roger Harris. There were so many really, really good composers coming through, and Lenny was the one who could conduct them, because he was clearly, from his success in New York and elsewhere, he was obviously on the way to being a great conductor. So for 7 years, Bernstein did not write another show for the theatre. He was invited to. The people he'd worked with loved working with him, Comden and Green, the lyricists and book writers. But no, he played fair by Koussevitzky, and he became probably the most successful American conductor up till that time. All over Europe, he was conducting in Holland and in Germany and Austria even, and in England. I mean, he was very successful. Then 1951 is a kind of deadline year, because he's got so tired of conducting, because he's on the go all the time. He's not got a permanent job, he's a guest conductor. He's got so weary, he says, I want to be a composer after all. And Koussevitzky died, so there was no longer the pressure on him to be a conductor. And he took a sabbatical year, and with him on his sabbatical notes, he took his sketch for an opera, and that opera was Trouble in Tahiti. I think Bernstein had a great love of words. I know that Bernstein had a great love of words, because he loved doing crossword puzzles, and he'd do word games with his family. He had three kids, and they all adored playing Scrabble and three-dimensional Scrabble, I think they played sometimes. I mean, enormously complicated. And that comes out, his love of language, in the libretto here. I mean, there's these scat songs which the trio sing, which I can't reproduce them now, but doobie-doop, doobie-doop, it's very doobie-doop, in the little white house song. It's got rhythm to it, and it's got the sound of the Andrews sisters, or Ella Fitzgerald singing scat songs. It's very much of its time. The whole opera is very much of its time in the 50s, and yet, like other great operas like Poulenc and Benjamin Britten, they survive and they come through. And odd enough with Bernstein, I think his reputation has increased rather than decreased since his death. I think more and more people are coming to realize that he wasn't only a very great interpreter of other composers like Copland or Gustav Mahler, of course, but he also had... He was probably more like Mahler than anybody else, in the sense that he had equal skills as a composer and a conductor. Now, why do you think Bernstein wanted to write about a suburban couple? He wanted to write about America, that's for sure. He wanted to write something, I think he said somewhere, I want to write an opera that will be understood by Americans and appreciated by Americans on an American theme, and where the American language is set so that it feels right when it's sung. It doesn't sound awkward. He certainly succeeded in that. He chose this suburban subject, I think, because he was still remembering, 10 years after he left home, he was still remembering the tensions in his own home. Now, it's a story about just a couple who they've got a child of 8 or 10, and they're living in a suburb. Well, Bernstein's own family did live in a suburb of Boston. And from the commentary that the chorus sing, it's clear that it could be a suburb of Chicago, it could be a suburb of Philadelphia, it could be a suburb of Washington. It's a suburb, that's the point about it. And this couple aren't getting on well, and they squabble. And Bernstein must have meant to get his own back in some way on his parents, because he called the male of the pub Sam, Samuel. His own father's name was Samuel. He called the wife by his mother's name. In fact, I think somebody must have told him that was a bit too fierce, and so in the end called her Dinah, which is the name of one of his own aunts, but his mother's name was Jenny. But the implication is clearly that Bernstein was in some way writing about his own family. Not himself, because he loved his wife and they were very intelligent, witty, sharp people who were right up in psychiatrists. Bernstein saw a shrink virtually every day, for year after year after year, all through his 20s and 30s, and was part of daily life. I think he saw the same psychiatrist as Jerome Robbins. Sometimes he saw psychiatrists who were paid in French lessons or something else. I mean, they were all friends together. It was all a circle, but psychiatry was part of it. So that the woman going to see a psychiatrist was part of his world, not his mother's world. His mother and father would never have dreamt of going to a psychiatrist. But the mother and the father were not at ease with each other, and there's that tension which Bernstein was exploring. But I think that's only an incidental. The opera's not about Mrs. Jenny Bernstein and Mr. Samuel Bernstein. The opera is about America post-war, the boom of advertising. Everybody's got all they not want from a material point of view, but have they got inner strength? Have they got personal beliefs and so on? And that's really what Bernstein was homing in on. And it wasn't a particularly romantic subject. The relationship is rather negative. There's no great discovery of love, which is what opera is often about. But there's enough variety of feeling in it, I think, for it to be very touching. When Bernstein was constructing his libretto, when he was writing out this story, it's very hard to know how much was conscious and how much was subconscious, but there is the fact that neither of these two parents take the trouble to go and hear their son, see their son acting in the school play, which is obviously a parent's duty, and fathers should get away from work if they possibly can too. He says, I've got to go to this gym, I've got to win this competition for fitness, and she doesn't give any reasons why she didn't go. She just ends up in a cinema, very disrespectful, I think, and very irresponsible. And there's a one note in Bernstein's life when he was playing the Greek piano concerto, big concerto, in a semi-professional concert, and his father didn't turn up. And was he getting his own back by saying that parents are letting people down? I guess consciously he would have said, no, that's nothing to do with it at all, but maybe there was a hint of that in Bernstein. But then, you know, Bernstein's too important an artist, too substantial an artist for it to be just a question of working out his hatred or his dislikes. He actually kept very close to his parents. He never broke away from them. And his father had the enormous... he had to swallow so much pride because his father wanted him to follow into the hairdressing industry, which he created in Boston. He was the patent holder for the... No, he held the local franchise for a hair-drying gadget called the Frederick's hair-drying machine, which had six or eight tubes that came down from the ceiling, and women ensconced themselves in these things for 3 or 4 hours while their hair was set. And the Frederick's machine was so successful that at the time of the Depression, when everybody else was losing money hand over foot, Samuel Bernstein was in fact becoming very prosperous. But he didn't want his son to be a musician, not a composer. He was proud of the fact that his son played the piano well, in fact bought him a grand piano, took him on a tour, but he stopped him from having lessons. He wouldn't pay for him to have lessons. Bernstein for a year went out and earned money himself by playing for dance clubs and things in order to earn the $3 or $4 that he needed to pay his teacher for his lessons. I think after a year his father realized that he'd been too heavy-handed and started to pay for the lessons again himself. So that the relationship between father and mother and son was nothing like as tense as the one in Trouble in Tahiti. So far as the themes of Trouble in Tahiti are concerned, I don't think we should get too impassioned about them. They're not as important as Britain's War Requiem. They're not about conscientious objection. They're not about pacifism. They are about the inability of love to be sustained over a long period, unless you're exceptionally lucky. And the themes which Bernstein dealt with, the house that's got all the gadgets and all the toasters and milk-making machines, ice-cream-making machines and so on, that's very much of the time. I think everybody was mocking Brecht, was having a go at capitalism even before the war. And I think that Bernstein was on a fairly clear and obvious wicket in this case. He was scoring points that other people had scored too. I think the splendid thing about Trouble in Tahiti is that he did it with such concise terms that he, in just seven or eight numbers, he scored so many bullseyes and really struck home. The problem in performance with Trouble in Tahiti is what to put it with. At one time, I think he was thinking of writing some other operas and maybe a more serious one. Or I think when it was first performed, it was actually put on the same bill as a Bertolt Brecht musical, Threepenny Opera, so that one was able to have the master and the pupil almost, because the music of Kurt Weill is one of the sources from which Bernstein gathered his strength. Only one of many sources. There's not. When you hear Trouble in Tahiti, you don't think all the time, oh, that's a bit of Copland, or that's a bit of Britten, or that's a bit of Walton. It's not like that. Bernstein does, I think, already have a very individual voice. But nevertheless, it does have, at the back of his mind, he does have consumerism as something to have a go at, have fun with, and psychiatry is another thing to have fun with, because he'd been through that himself. And neglect of one's children, of course, is something that everybody talks about, always does. I can confidently say he's a man of television. I mean, he adored television. His reputation was to some extent made on television, although he had a big success when he was a young man taking over from Bruno Walter, and although he conducted all over America and he conducted orchestras all over Europe in the 40s and 50s, it was the fact that he started doing regular television programs as a pundit, as an enthusiast, as a teacher, as a lecturer. I mean, he talked about Beethoven's sketchbooks and how they fitted together, how you could work out how Beethoven refined his Fifth Symphony. Da 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 da. There's three G's and an E flat, he'd say in the studio, pointing with his foot at the music score, which was painted on the studio floor. And from that, he worked out a whole system of symphonies. And later on, he did What is Jazz? And he did a marvelous program about Oedipus. And I mean, he taught grown-ups. And then he taught young people in his famous Young People's Concerts for 15 years at the New York Philharmonic. But it wasn't only that. He also then arranged for all his films, he later arranged for all his concerts to be filmed. And I had the joy, I think I did about 300 concerts. Mahler symphonies, Schumann, Brahms, Haydn, Sibelius, his own music, all on celluloid for permanent use. And so there's a record there, which he felt was very important. It wasn't because he was overweening in his self-importance. He knew he was a good conductor. And he didn't actually get on too well with feature films. He made one very good feature film. Elia Kazan was the director. On the Waterfront was the film with Marlon Brando, set in the rough Dockland areas of New Jersey and about a stool pigeon, somebody who squeals. It's a tough, tough, very tough black and white film. And his music is very black and white tough too. But he didn't like the way that the director pushed it into the background so that you could hear Marlon Brando's grunts. And he wrote rather fiercely against that, and as a result of which, I think he wasn't too keen to get back to the movies. Although he did once talk for many months with Zeffirelli about making a film about St. Francis of Assisi, but in the end, he gave that up. He didn't like the way that he wanted a more poetic approach to cinema, whereas Zeffirelli wanted to make money and make sure that the show was box office. And Bernstein had a very poetic, private feeling about how film would work, which is why he was so happy with the 1973 production of Trouble in Tahiti. And also, I'm sure he'd have been overjoyed if he'd seen this particular production, this new Tom Cairns production, because it does everything that visuals can do without getting in the way of the music. And that's, of course, what he was... The music must be always first. All our work in television, DVD, any kind of video, is at the service of the music, he'd say. And bravo, I agree with that 100%. And I think he wanted, in his minor way, in his small way, to create something in the way that Wagner did, a Gesamtkunstwerk, a totally everything all together, painting and theatre and music all and word all being rolled into one. It's maybe a bit pompous to talk about trouble in Tahiti in that way, but that's what he wanted. And I think Bernstein was, in a sense, a visionary. He was a visionary in so many things, because he was a visionary in the sense that he saw the greatness of Gustav Mahler before most people did, and went into his work at the New York Philharmonic determined to do all Mahler's symphonies, which he did quite soon. He was a visionary, though, in terms of his own work, in that he saw that out of the musical comedy, West Side Story, and before that, On the Town and One Another, out of this work could come something which was more permanent and which would attract the greatest voices of the time. When you're doing Broadway shows, you have to have people, hoofers, who can both sing and dance and act a bit. When you go into the opera house, you have to have the very best singers, because they've got to fill a house, 2,000-3,000 people. They've got to have big voices, and he instinctively wrote for the best. Now, I remember when we did West Side Story, we made a film about his recording of West Side Story, and people were a little bit critical of Jose Carreras and Kiri Takanawa. They were too operatic. He said, no, you don't understand. This is what I want. I want the greatest voices in the whole wide world to sing my music. And here, with Kiri Takanawa, the greatest lyric soprano of her age, and Jose as well. And it's such a joy for me, he says, to hear this music. Well, the same with Trouble in Tahiti. He wanted to have the best in all fields. He wanted it to look good. He wanted it to sound. He'd have been delighted by this new production, because the skill with which Tom Cairns has developed the filmic side, the visual side, the way he's woven the trio into the action, it's absolutely marvellous. But I think after Trouble in Tahiti, Bernstein's operatic ambitions were sort of sidetracked for a bit. We're talking 1950s. He wrote a lot of music then. He wasn't conducting regularly. He didn't have a symphonic post until 57, when he took over the New York Philharmonic. And the previous 6 years he wrote Candide, which is a marvellous satirical operetta. It wasn't called an operetta at the time, because it was done on Broadway and they thought operetta would frighten people away, so it was a musical. It's a satirical musical, and now it's done in opera houses as often as it's done in the theatre. He wrote a great film score, which should have won Oscars but didn't, On the Waterfront. He wrote a very charming musical, which is called A Wonderful Town. He wrote a fine violin concerto, his Serenade, written for Isaac Stern. And he wrote music for Peter Pan, a theatre piece, very substantial music. He was in the theatre, therefore, still, but opera was, as it were, on the side waiting while he did other things, because the call to write musicals, which was, he needed money. And you don't earn money writing an opera. You earn money by writing musicals, or writing film scores, or conducting. And in fact, he got one excellent job which did reinforce his love of opera, and that was he went to La Scala, Milan. He was the first American to conduct at La Scala in 1954. And the result of that can be heard in his operetta Candide, because he sends up, he guys, he mocks the conventions of opera seria, of Bellini and Donizetti, of bel canto rather than opera seria. He has a lot of fun at the expense of opera in his Candide. But he also got to know the feeling of an opera house. His star singer at La Scala was none other than Maria Callas. You know, nothing but the best for Bernstein. His director was Visconti, one of the great directors. Later on he worked with Zeffirelli, and he worked with Otto Schenk in Vienna. I mean, he always worked with the very best people. So he did do opera for the rest of his life often. He wrote, he conducted Carmen at the New York Metropolitan, he conducted Falstaff at the Metropolitan Opera and in Vienna, he conducted Tristan in Munich. And finally, in the 1980s, he got round to writing his own big opera, A Quiet Place. And the funny thing is that in that big opera, it actually incorporates the small opera from 30 years earlier. A Quiet Place is about the same dysfunctional family that we met, Sam and Dinah and the unseen boy. And that unseen boy comes home to roost, as you might say, in A Quiet Place. And embedded in A Quiet Place is the whole of Trouble in Tahiti. It's an astonishing thing, but that's for another DVD, I think.
Bernstein was the toast of New York. He celebrated the fact that he was celebrated by New York and by its public and by its orchestras and its musicians. He belonged in every party, in every hot spot of New York, if you like, musically, artistically, socially. And he celebrated that in so many pieces. Fancy Free, On the Town, Wonderful Town, On the Waterfront, of course, the big West Side Story, and indeed, sort of, in a much darker way in Trouble in Tahiti, which of course takes place in a rather different milieu, and the piece disappointed people who wanted yet another wonderful celebration of the joy or the passion and the craziness of living in New York. This was a piece about what goes wrong when the expectations kind of created by materialism, by this the new boom, by the end of the war. This piece belongs right at the beginning of the 50s. It was started in 1951, performed in 1952, a time of great confidence, a time of people expecting the best out of their new car, their new home. People were, you know, the whole business of owning the new, great, burgeoning future. And Bernstein turned around and said, well, actually, okay, you have your little white house, you have all your stuff. The trio, this sort of scat trio, which is there always in the background and kind of troubling us with these views and these images and these ideas of what this great new white hope future will be, completely undercut by the story, which is, of course, that people love grace, a sense of trust and being able to look after each other doesn't suddenly come right just because you pile possessions and a new prosperity into the world. And indeed, as we know, as history repeatedly tells us, at times of great, if you like, boom and material wealth, society often falls apart in the middle, and that's what this piece is about. It's a very testing piece for the singers. It's vocally extremely demanding. Because not only vocally is it very, very extended, and some of the scenes, Sam in his shower, in his gym scene, you know, this music is demands extraordinary kind of extension of the voice both ways, the kind of thing that doesn't happen in perhaps the rather easier tessitura, the easier range that you would encounter in some easier musicals around the same time. But also because you're dealing, and this is something that Bernstein said he composed, it's absolutely there, it's clear for us to see this, he's dealing with deeply serious issues. So you're dealing with issues that you could be dealing with in a Verdi opera, or, you know, and digging that deep. But you're also dealing with them, because of the way Bernstein's written the music, on a deliberately light and very, very easily lightly clothed kind of musical style. So you're having to play with your voice in a very light way at times, but actually discover very deep and very troubling things through the words, through the music, and the pulling music and drama both ways in this kind of ironic way puts big demands on the interpretation. And I think it's very easy to attend to the scat rhythms or to the easy jazz rhythms or to the kind of scherzo rhythms of the music. It's very hard then to find the colours which are very deeply buried in this very personal story. It doesn't get performed very often because it doesn't fit anywhere, because it is unique, because it stands completely on its own. It's not an opera. Yes, it's an opera in the sense that it's singers and it's a fairly conventional instrumental ensemble. It's too short for an opera. And indeed, in the beginning, one of his influences was Puccini, whose Tritica, the three parts in three short operas in one evening, was a very strong influence. He wanted to somehow make Trouble in Tahiti part of that. Later in life, he then went on to write a sequel, a rather longer piece called A Quiet Place, which it comes from this idea that Dinah talks about, that trying to find this quiet place in her life, and that engendered this many, many years later, the sequel, which has nothing musically to do with Trouble in Tahiti. It goes off in completely different directions musically. It's not a musical, which is what the critics would have loved it to be. It's not a Broadway piece. It's not a film piece per se. It's capable of being interpreted in so many different ways. But I think the most difficult thing is that it's not a comfortable piece, that you don't feel good in the sense that you don't go away whistling the tunes that made you feel happy. It's incredibly tuneful, and musically it's very, very direct and very simple, and communicates in an incredibly touching way. I mean, it's very... I find myself getting very tearful when listening to my own personal response, I suppose, listening to this woman trying to find out what it is about her life that's gone missing, that what it is that this relationship with this man who she once loved has kind of left her high and dry, and he indeed as well. But that sense of emptiness with the warmest music is an extraordinary kind of pull, a kind of sort of tug at the heartstrings. But not all music, not all music theatre, not all drama makes you feel kind of warm inside and satisfied and reassures you about your life. I think at the time, it was particularly difficult for people to actually listen to a piece that was about the trouble and the anxiety of the age, when actually what they wanted to look forward to was a very bright, easy sort of sunrise future. And Bernstein wasn't prepared to give them that. It's very uncompromising. And it will always be difficult to encounter pieces like that. But actually, you come out the other side. It's rather like the characters at the end of King Lear, when they actually can see that what they have lived through will give them some new and better appreciation of what they should be doing with their own lives. And I think that's something that's very, very deeply satisfying about watching this piece or performing this piece.